Managing empires, cooperation, competition, conflict was the topic of the annual conference 2013. The conference was hosted by the cluster Asia and Europe in a global context and organized by Diamantis Panagiotopoulos and researchers from Research Area A, Governance and Administration. At this year's conference, the cluster welcomed over 200 guests from all around the world.
Hello, my name is Zhuma. I come from China.
My name is Natsuke Tokumaru. I'm coming from Kyoto, Japan.
Hello, my name is Martin Deisenberry, and I'm from Newcastle University in Great Britain.
This year, we invited special speakers for the keynote lectures. The first keynote lecture was held by Professor Michael Burrows from Oxford University, who talked about Napoleon's reign over Europe.
A great many of the attitudes, I think I should call them, towards colonial peoples were developed first by Napoleonic administrators in other parts of Europe. I think particularly in Italy and in the Balkans, to a certain extent in Germany and the Netherlands as well. And particularly at the level of policy, this idea that French imperialists developed of having to have a civilizing mission to change other peoples, to make them more like France, was very powerful in this period, and it is the first direct link to the later colonialisms.
Another distinguished keynote speaker invited to the conference was Professor Harald Gluck from Columbia University, who gave a lecture on modernity and Japan.
So I speak as a historian concerned with broadening the way we look at modern history, in my case, to see the histories not only within the prison house of national boundaries, but to see the commonalities and connections among the different inflections of modernity around the world. I believe that modernity is a process over the past 300 years in which there are many more commonalities and connections than are usually emphasized, and that my hope was to use Japan as an instance of a common modernity, which of course is differently inflected and experienced in Japan, but actually is common with the rest of the world. And so that is my goal actually as a historian.
Besides the keynote lectures, the conference presented a variety of panel discussions about case studies in Asia and Europe. One lecture by Yan Haiping was about China.
I think it is, for one, a very specific case study of a group of artists in China, but they have become internationally and globally extremely well respected. And these are special artists. They have their special creative experiences, which I would like to share, given my research and my understanding with audience members all over the world.
Jivanta Shetty's research was about CEOs in India.
Indian CEOs of major industrial companies are very much aware of global competition and global opportunities. On the one hand, they are expanding internationally, so they realize that they have to also be more culturally adept in other contexts, including European, so not only in new emerging markets, but in old established markets. So I think that makes a big difference. A lot of these companies are going to the United States and also coming to Europe. So they realize that they need different tools and techniques to compete and be successful. At the same time, they are aware of their disadvantages from the Indian perspective in terms of a long period where the economy was closed, where capital was controlled. So it's an interesting combination on the one hand of realizing the domestic constraints, but not so much in terms of welfare and poverty issues that didn't really feature in the interviews, but in terms of their abilities to compete globally.
For the first time, the Digital Humanities Cafe opened its doors. Besides coffee and cake, visitors could explore tools and databases developed by researchers from the Heidelberg Research Architecture and Project Subaltern Diplomacy.
For us researchers doing global history and transcultural history, it is especially important to know where we can search for sources, because many of us deal with border-crossing actors within their research. And it's very hard to trace them empirically, because many records and sources are scattered over various archives, and you have to collect and visit many archives. And digital resources, catalogs, and databases can help to get an overview over what sources exist, where you can find them, and thereby are helpful resources to make your research a bit easier, at least via digital support.
Both the lecturers and the participants were very satisfied with the conference.
A conference like this that engages the issues of the past and present in a transcultural context is a wonderful opportunity, and the papers were terrific. And I think they were terrific because the vantage point of all of these people is much broader than the conventional viewpoint of scholars. So I was delighted to be a part of it.
And what about the organizer, Diamantis Panagiotopoulos?
We've had actually so far only positive feedback, and we are of course very happy. I think a very good indication that it worked is the fact that we had very lively discussions and debates, which showed that most of the panels have the potential to be studied more extensively and with new methods in the future.
The next annual conference will be organized by Research Area B, Public Spheres, and will take place in October 2014.